Okay, the intent of my talk is just to highlight our collaboration between DPR and the Water Board. You know, the State Water Board has statewide monitoring and regional monitoring that was established by Lori yesterday. And the DPR has agricultural monitoring and urban monitoring that was established by Robert and Shu yesterday. So we collaborate with our statewide program and regional program. So this the intent is to show you how we do that project. So the SPOT is our statewide program. It was designed to monitor all quality pests, not only pesticides, and to relate that to soil, like land. That was how it was designed. But throughout the years, it has evolved. We did a review of the project after 5 years, and we kind of rearranged it. We started off with 100 site samples, fixed sites for monitoring at the bottom of the watershed. We used to go every year to those 100 sites and sample sediment for analysis. But after the review, we reduced the size. Every year we go out and sample only 50 sites for annual. So 50 sites are biannual. So similarly, we have also adjusted the compounds we are monitoring. For example, OTs, PCBs, and organophosphates. We go out to sample biannually, not annually as used to be. So toxicity, we test it with Hyalella azotica, and we do it on all 100 sites. But Sonomus, we do it only for urban sites, 40 sites here. And we have also called the toxicity test, which we sample for from 25 sites, like what Greg described before, called temperature test. We do it. So annually, we sample 75. So the collaboration started after DPR put the phytoid level restriction. So both agencies are interested to evaluate the effectiveness of that regulation. So we start collaborating with Robert in Southern California and myself in Northern California. So we basically intensified the sampling. That's what we did. The sampling site we have, the DPR has, and Water Board has, we intensified the sampling and analysis. So DPR covers most of the chemistry studies, and Water Board covers the toxicity studies. So these are the four sites we are collaborating with. Kirker Creek is both sites, distributes both sites. Pleasant Grove is the DPR site. Bucket Canyon is both sites. And Salt Creek is original site. What's the DPR site? So we also collaborate on frequently for DPR funds about 10 sites for spot. So this is the result we found from collaboration. So you see the year-round on the first column, survival, some of parameters, and so on. These are the findings. 2008, 2010, that was before we started collaboration. That was the year SPOT program started. So we don't have a joint. 2013, A, B, C, D is the number of times we go out for sample. In 2013, we go out 4 times for sample. So as you can see, you don't see any substantial trend in any of the parameters in Kirker site. So this is Pleasant Grove site, DPR site. Again, because we started in 2030 collaboration, so you can see there is a consistent detection of the parameters and the components. But we don't see much trend. There's not much trend. And the survival is okay on this site. This is where the change comes in Front Creek. Low survival, higher detection of fipronil and parasites. But still the trend, you don't see that much upward or downward trend. We have not determined that. That means we need more data for this site to determine the concentration, the trend. This is Burkitt County. So this is where the highest toxicity is existing, this site. So you see the pyrene source and pyrrolysis, it is very high. But we don't know which one is causing the toxicity until we do further study. But still, you know, between the years, you don't see much difference. It's up and down. So this is a summary of the study. Pyrethroid and pyrethroid were detected in all of the samples. No clear reduction in pyrethroid at any site. Okay, and concentration at all spots. Okay, preliminary analysis of 2014 data suggests clear detection. Yeah, there was detection, but there's no threat. Concentration of pyrethroid at intensive sites would be toxic to chronomers. You know, that is a different species we introduced in 2014. Before that, we were relying only on Hyalina. So with this species, we were able to detect pyrethroid and okay, 2015, we have finished this year. Okay, the other collaboration we did is with the regional monitoring program and the agricultural monitoring program of DPR. So region 3 and region 7 are the ones who are supporting this study. So we sampled Chromanus and Hyalella for 10-day test. We support the toxicity part of the study, the DPR supports the chemical concentration. So these are the various compounds we are measuring. Quote-unquote emerging, that pyrethroid, organophosphate, pyrethroid, herbicides, and so on. Measure all these ones. So region 3 supports nine sites. Region 8, region 7, 8, and 9. So future collaboration, we are hoping to have with in region 5. And region 3 and 7, we
will still negotiate for 2015 and more
sampling. So that's all I have on this one. So these are the contact persons from Spotlight. These are the lead scientists for us, for DPR, Robert, and Shu. Yeah.
I'm going to be able to say water. Maybe when we face up with your name, we're in a more easier format. Yeah. I appreciate that. I actually serve on the thought scientific panel, so I just want to make three points. One, this project, the spot, does a really good job of what I call adaptive decision-driven science. And I've seen that in the 6 years that I've been serving on that panel here at Hale. So, you know, mid-free, you know, just tagging on what Greg said, where we need to look at what's coming down the pipe, what tools do we need to evolve in this program instead of going, these are the things that we used 5 years ago, we're sticking with trends. You know, we're not only just asking trend kind of questions, we're asking trend. And then the collaborative piece, I really want to give full stars for this project because they are doing this intensive urban monitoring at the inside to try to get at what I think we need to think about is when management makes decisions, as Greg says, they go up the chain and they go, we're going to implement this reg or we're going to fund this project, they need to know how did my management decisions affect change. And so this study is focusing in on DPR put in those surface water regs. If we can show that those are effective, then we can then go, how do we roll that out to the next pesticide? So those are my two things. My third thing I just want to say is, interesting on your slides, Dewey, where you showed the toxicity results and then the chemistry is pending. So what does that mean? It means in toxicity, you know, it's not both dogs need to be in the race. We talk and chemistry and our tools, but the tech, the tox tells us in real time what the animals are doing. And because the story we're hearing all throughout this is there's multiple specified, so we need to use multiple species. And then the chemistry, we're usually waiting on those results. So if we want to make faster things in time, we need that chemistry, that toxicity, so that can tell us in real time how to make those real-time decisions.
The way that FORCE set up is that it is a toxicity-based monitoring. So each of the compounds we are measuring it will be some kind of toxicity test associated with it. So the primary drive is toxicity.
I have a question. You may have said it, so I'm sorry if I missed it, but how frequently are the analytes changed? So what is the process for either introducing a new compound to analyze for or eliminating one that's not?
Yeah, we do have annual meetings, annual science advisory meeting, which we hold it in April. DPR is a part of it. I see Robert coming to that meeting. So what we did is, after we did 5 years of sampling and analysis and report writing, that is the time we revised. The science panel said, okay, we have seen this kind of trend. So do we need to adjust the monitoring budget? So we have done it 5 years back, but in between also there is a time we added new chemicals like triponic and chrome number testing. And also there is a Siano testing in the sediment aspect. All those things were added piece by piece depending on the need. So usually the annual meeting is the one that determines the direction of the device. So it is in effect.
The other thing too, besides adding, if you've been involved in long-term monitoring programs, scientists are very, very reluctant to let go of something monitored for a long time. And by looking at things like DDT or PCBs, that we're not really doing anything to, we're not using it anymore, we're not mitigating for it, and we're not seeing changes. We need to feel comfortable about thinking about reducing the frequency of monitoring so that you can spend your limited resources on other things. And we tend to do that a lot in a regulatory situation. We need to also evaluate data when we need to stop asking for data about certain things. And that's very hard for us to do. And so look for signs that, you know, our people that we regulate, it's important to look at that data and decide, look, it's not causing a problem, it's not changing. We should put that resources towards other issues. So it's not just adding new things, but also do we feel comfortable enough with the science to let go or reduce the frequency of the time?
Another thing which I always think is between DPR and the water board, you know, how to look for the surveillance part of the emerging compound. How frequently we have to do it, how do we strategize to look for that one. I know that DPR has model for prioritization and so on, but it looks to be viewed also from a little bit from the water perspective as well. So those things should be worked out on that one. But right now, sport does not really go after emergency. Most of the time, they are more like,